to the track. The wall makes the leap and makes the catch. Amazing catch by Junior.
He got it. A perfect game. 13 strikeouts.
Kicking out towards straightaway center field. Kicking out for right center. Trout at the wall. Leaps up and he makes the catch. Mike Trout with another spectacular grab. There is out number two. Barnes hit for high. It's a game. It's a game. 7-56.
What a special moment for Barry Bonds.
Hello and welcome to the Champions Adjust podcast. This is your most favorite baseball podcast with me, Aaron Mashvitz, aka Jackson Stone, and the one and only, the podcast famous Coach David Bodson.
AKA David Bodson.
AKA Big Bods, Papa Bods, Big Daddy Bods.
Big Daddy Bods, I love it.
We're in October, special month for all baseball fans. Beautiful October is a fantastic month.
Spooky month.
Yes. Oh, Halloween month, playoff Hocus baseball
Pocus
month.
Hocus 2 is out.
Oh, did you watch it? It was good.
I did. You know what? The first one scared the shit out of me.
Hard same.
And still kind of does. Hard same. And this one is more like lovey-dovey Disney-esque.
Oh, really?
And it was a little disappointing, but still funny. So I recommend you watch it with low expectations of being scared, but high expectations of being entertained.
We're
going to get Disney to sponsor our podcast one day.
Yeah. October for me ranks like in the top 3 months of the year for me.
Okay.
What about you?
June is my favorite month.
Same. Birthday months.
Well, birthday months. So, but also because there's Lola. She's here's something. Because you have NHL playoffs, NBA finals, the College World Series, the US Open for tennis, and then just baseball in general is just like it's in the middle of the heart of the season for Major League Baseball,
right?
And it's like good luck finding a better month for being a sports fan,
right?
It's just incredible. Plus, it's our birthday months.
It's our birthday
it's
month.
Like the one day I can sit in bed and not have any expectations of me. I'm like,
and it's the hottest time of the year to coach baseball outside in Texas, which is awesome. We love it.
I'm passing out.
We live for it.
Pickle juice.
Pickle juice for the win.
Absolutely. yeah, October is phenomenal for me too because think about it, I love the Dallas Stars and Stars hockey starting up. Big Mavericks fan. Mavericks basketball starting up.
Mm-hmm.
But also playoff baseball, which we're both Cardinals fans.
Right.
And very rarely do we not get to watch October baseball.
Right.
Which makes it that much more exciting. There is one piece of sad news this year that is like a piece of my childhood is dying. This is the first year since I was like 10 years old that Joe Buck is not calling the World Series this year.
Oh, wow. I didn't know that.
Yeah, he signed that big ESPN contract.
Oh, right.
With Troy Aikman. Good for him.
Yeah, great.
He signed that. He automatically disqualified himself from calling the World Series.
So who's doing the Fox World Series? Do we know?
We can discuss that later. It's somebody who is deserving, but it's not Joe Buck.
Fair enough. Fair enough.
People hate on Joe Buck, right?
Like, I think he did a great job.
The thing about Joe Buck is name another human being who can call an NFL game in the morning in Charlotte and then flies to New York for a World Series game that night and is brushed up on the research and kills it on both of those.
Right.
The guy doesn't sleep before he does that, and then people hone in on like a mistake he made on one of those broadcasts. And it's like, yeah, the guy's gotten five hours of sleep this week alone just so he can be brushed up and entertain you.
Yeah.
So he's going to make a mistake here and there because he's a human being.
Right.
But the guy works so hard, and he is the voice of a generation for World Series baseball.
Yeah, he is.
And the son of Cardinals great Jack Buck. So he's a big Cardinals fan too. Joe is.
Well, shout out to Joe, man. We love Joe.
Shout out to Joe. Love him. Very sad not be hearing you this year calling the World Series. But yeah.
But speaking of that, we are in October, and the Champions Adjust podcast is doing our famous. These were very well received last season, yes. So that's why we're doing them again this season. Because we specifically cover on this podcast, if you're new, mostly youth baseball. because that's where our that's kind of where our feet are in right now. But we decided to do some postseason episodes last year, and they went over really well, audio and on YouTube. And so we're doing them again this year. So this is our first one of the series. What we'll do here is we're going to try to pump out as many episodes as possible through the month of October. So they're not going to come on like a very consistent schedule in terms of it'll drop this day, this day, this day. We're going to try to sit down here and record as many days throughout the week so we can be up to date as possible. And the episodes will just come out as it is. And then that'll take us through the month of October. And then November and December will probably take off unless we feel inclined not to.
Ooh, I want
to
do some.
We haven't really decided that past this yet. Hopefully we can do some guests. If we can keep doing it more regularly.
Several of them might be listening to this today. Just so you guys know, it is tough, right, to meet. We are not we don't get paid for this. We do this because we love to do it, right? Mm-hmm. And I have a 7-week today old son. And I also travel for work sometimes, and Aaron has 5 to 6 jobs at any given time. And so we were supposed to do this 5 days ago, and then we were supposed to do this yesterday, and then we're doing it today about an hour after we were supposed to do it, because it's just, when does the schedule work out? Mm-hmm. So this episode is on, we're filming on Friday,
the very first day of playoffs. 7th
playoffs start in about an hour. We'll do our wild card predictions today, and high level World Series predictions too. And then, every round we'll meet back up and make our divisional and our CS and World Series picks. Even though I've already made my World Series pick,
same,
and you have too. And what was it that you said?
I said Cardinals over Yankees in Cardinals 6. Over
Yankees in 6, and I said, I'm not sure how many games, but I did say Astros over Braves in 6. And now that I've done more research, I maintain that I believe it's going to be the Astros winning the World Series.
Yeah.
A couple quick shout-outs before we get into our episode. One, of course, Champions Adjust. We have our gear.
Yeah.
ChampionsAdjust.com.
Yep. ChampsAdjust.com.
ChampsAdjust.com. Excuse me.
ChampsAdjust.com.
So please, give us a shout. Give us a look. Hit us up if there's anything specific in terms of merchandise you're looking for.
Yeah.
Also want to give a quick shout out with the shirt that I'm wearing right now. It is Cardinals. It is Happy Cardinals Day. I have become more active on Twitter with what we call Cardinals Twitter, where I just get followed by a lot of Cardinals fans. I've become friends with them. And at Cardinals GIFs and at Tweeto, who run the Turn Into podcast, which is a Cardinals based podcast.
That's a great name for a podcast.
It's great. But they also run Birds in the Black pod, which is a Cardinals minor league. And please, if you're listening to this and I just got this wrong, let us know in the comments and I will absolutely fix it next week. But the shirt was created by them, and feel it. Like, the material is phenomenal and the print is phenomenal. And all the proceeds, it's Yadier Molina holding the Puerto Rico flag, and all the proceeds of the shirt go to hurricane relief, Hurricane Fiona relief in Puerto Rico, which, they got hit very hard. So we'll put the link on this clip and we'll post it up. But at Cardinals GIF, at Tweeto, at Birds in the Black, and at Turn Into Podcast, they put together this really cool fundraiser that I wanted to give a quick shout out to before we get into this, because I think it's a really cool concept, especially if you're a Cardinals fan. You should absolutely be getting one of these, because it supports Yachty. But most importantly, it supports the hurricane relief funds for Puerto Rico.
That's right. Beautiful.
That is my piece.
Sweet. Thank you for sharing, and thank you for those guys for doing that work of highlighting minor league baseball, highlighting the Cardinals, and using their platform to make some good in the world, which is basically what I believe social media is the best for. So, awesome. So, let's get into it, Coach.
Let's do it.
Friday, October 7th.
Here we go. It's 6:40 a.m. right now.
We got four baseball games today.
Fun. This is fun, man.
We have 12 teams in the playoffs.
New format.
Very brand new format. Yeah. What are your initial thoughts on the format?
I love it, man. I think a lot of what they're trying to do is make it more NCAA-esque, right? It's a response to new brackets. I filled out a bracket today for potentially winning $100,000, but with the way they do it, it's fill out the bracket and then tell them how many home runs you think are going to be hit and how many runs overall are going to be scored across the whole, across the entire playoffs. And it's hard. And so the closest to that, who gets the bracket right, wins $100,000.
Yeah.
Which is, it's cool. I also, we talked about this last year. I am pro expanding the playoffs to six teams each, especially with this eliminating the one game playoff.
Right.
I don't like the one game. I never liked the one game playoff idea because baseball is not a win or go home sport.
Right.
It's a chess match. Mm-hmm. It's hard to play a chess match in a one game.
In one game, right, right, right.
So, four games started today. Those are three game series that mm-hmm. are all at home for the higher seed. Mm-hmm. For example, the Cardinals are hosting the Phillies today. Mm-hmm. The Mets are hosting the Padres. The Blue Jays are hosting. You just scrolled up.
The Mariners.
Mariners. The Mariners. And what else am I looking
at? And the Guardians and the Rays.
They're hosting the Rays.
Yep.
I was like reading off your screen and going away from that. But yeah, so I'm a fan. I love it. I'm very excited for this. And then, you know, also what's really cool about this is in the past, they reseed every round, which is a nightmare for logistics. So you look at like the VP of travel of a team. Hey, we just won at this score. That team, though, lost. So we thought we were going here on the West Coast. We're actually going to the East Coast, and we got to leave tomorrow. Mm-hmm. Book it up. And everybody's like, oh, okay. And then the fans are trying to travel to the team, and they have to cancel their flights and go
right,
to
right.
their stadium. Now, we know exactly what day Game 3 of the NLCS will be. And we know exactly where it will be played, considering what the seating is looking like.
Yeah.
Right? Like, we have a good idea of where it's going to be played. So that's really cool as well.
I like the format.
Okay.
But I think it's just different, right? Because there's never been a team with a bye.
Right.
So that already changes the whole dynamics of the playoffs.
Right.
Right? When you think about baseball, usually the team that wins the World Series is the one that's the hottest, has yes. the most momentum.
Yes.
And that's probably the team that had the shortest amount of break going into it.
Yes.
So you think about these teams that are the best in their league, the Yankees, the Astros, the Braves, and the Dodgers. Like, Dodgers and Astros, clearly the two best teams in the league throughout yes. 162 games of baseball, have the largest break off. And so, yes, the Dodgers and the Astros are playoff teams. They're perennial playoff teams. They understand the environment. They understand how they need to get prepared. They understand all of that stuff.
Right.
They're professionals to a T, but they still have a break. And that, we know, doesn't do great historically.
You're right.
In the playoffs. The Braves are probably the hottest team entering the playoffs because no one thought they were going to win the division.
God.
They were just absolutely smoked heading into September.
How tough is that for the Mets, by the way? To
right.
102 games and not win your division.
They win the division, but now they get a break.
Right.
I think the Braves would have been better off having that momentum, playing in a wild card, and then just keeping that running.
But how can you control that?
But you can't. You want to have the best regular season you can, right?
You have 100, and we can get into this later, but this is a big point of my predictions. Now you have the Mets who are going to host the Padres, and they're going to have to throw Scherzer and DeGrom, meaning that if they win, they're not going to be able to throw those two guys against the Dodgers until right. game 3 and 4.
Right.
Which could put them in an 0-2 hole.
Is a huge thing.
And that is huge. While the Dodgers are sitting at home resting, and yes, the momentum could be slowed down.
Right.
You're looking at the Mets, or you're looking at, I wouldn't say the Cardinals as much, but you're looking at the Guardians or the Rays or the Mariners, who are just so pitching heavy, are throwing their best guys 3 or 4 days before they go against mm-hmm. a significantly better bye team.
Right.
And that could, and to me, that's what baseball is all about.
So there's the advantages and the disadvantages, right?
Yeah, I just got chills talking about that.
Because the Dodgers getting a week off, you know, obviously helps Clayton Kershaw.
Yes.
Right? He needs the break.
May.
And yeah. he's an absolute stud. He could take 7 weeks off, he'll come back and he'll throw an 8-inning yes. shutout game. And so there's a lot of advantages and disadvantages. And then you look at a lot of the teams in the playoffs this year who haven't been in the playoffs for a really long time.
Mariners.
No, Mariners, I think Phillies, right? They both got their playoff drought done. Yeah,
2011.
Mariners in 2001 and Phillies in 2011 were the last.
No, and the Phillies lost to in 2011.
Yeah, the Cardinals.
The Cardinals, they were like the best team in baseball and they lost to the Cardinals.
The Cardinals won the World Series that year. The
Cardinals had snuck in mm-hmm. the last day of the season.
And so those two teams are interesting, right? The Padres and the Mets are interesting. because those kind of four teams aren't playoff teams.
My least favorite series is going to be the Guardians and the Rays.
Yeah? Why?
Just not excited about it. So the Guardians are a really fun team. Mm-hmm. I shouldn't say least excited.
Well, you're allowed to say that. You're watching four series. Right, right. That's the one you're least excited about.
Sure. You have a three seed who is in by far the weakest division in baseball.
Guardians.
And they didn't necessarily destroy their division.
No.
But they are a small ball team with really solid pitching. Mm-hmm. And Terry Francona, who is a genius of the chess player.
He's won World Series championships.
World Series.
Yeah. And they have a couple good barrels, right? They have the American League average leader.
Yeah, the Guardians are young, but they have the American League average leader. They have a lot of really...
Jose Ramirez, what's his... has like over 100 RBI, yes. Right? All of these things.
You have Steve Kwan, but then you have the Rays, who are...
We're a playoff team.
The Rays are one of those teams that they rarely win the division because you're in a division with...
Studs.
You know, the Yankees and the Red Sox, mm-hmm. and the Blue Jays now.
Right.
But... I mean, the AL East has three playoff teams. So, that was always a possibility, and it happened this year. Just like the NL East has three playoff teams. The Rays are really hard to count out.
They are.
They're really hard to count out. So that's an intriguing series. I'm just not... It's not sexy to me. Like,
yeah, it's not that sexy.
I have my predictions for the wildcard. We'll get into that. But,
those are some things.
Thanks.
I have a question to ask you before we just make specific picks.
Yeah.
Do you think Aaron Judge, during the playoffs, will set a postseason record for a number of walks?
What is the record for walks?
So I think it was Barry Bonds in 2002, World Series versus the Angels. Mm-hmm. In a 7-game series, he had 30 plate appearances and he had 13 walks.
Be really unpopular, in my opinion.
Seven of those were intentional.
Okay, that would be really unpopular.
So we're just talking about series.
Already last week.
Yep.
No, he's not as good of a hitter as Barry Bonds was. You can say he was natural and he's the first guy to do it naturally and he's so great. He's not as good of a hitter. You look at when he hit 61, from 60 to 61, and 61 to 62, and look at his strikeout rate. Was upwards of 20%. Like, he has good at-bats.
Mm, great at-bats.
But he's not as good. I mean, Barry Bonds is arguably the best hitter to ever play the game, ever, ever, ever. Mm-hmm. Steroids, no steroids. I don't care how many home runs he hits. It's the fact that he was that good of a freaking hitter.
Right.
He was so good. Aaron Judge is not Barry Bonds as far as plate appearances go, quality at-bats go, two-strike approach goes. Mm-hmm. He's not the same guy.
Right.
Barry Bonds is a guy... Didn't have to hit a home run to beat you.
No.
He comes up with the bases loaded and two outs. Could hit a double off the wall. He could hit a double in the gap. He's fast enough.
Or he's getting intentionally walked.
Which is why they intentionally walked him.
Right.
Pitchers don't fear Aaron Judge the way they feared Barry Bonds. And rightfully so.
Yeah.
Rightfully so. Aaron Judge struggles a little bit more with the off speed. Get him on a slider low and away. It's his like kryptonite.
Mm-hmm.
And it's not a bad kryptonite to have. It's a very... high probability kryptonite to have. But, yeah, he's just, no.
Not going to happen.
That's my long answer to no.
Not in a single series.
No.
It's not going to happen. I mean, I think, like, Albert Pujols in his prime is...
You mean right now?
Is leaps and bounds better than Aaron Judge.
Tell me a guy who hit 309 in the second half and hit 21 home runs is not in his prime right now?
Well, he's almost 50 years old.
Said it before, but if Albert Pujols is indeed older than what he says he is, then what has been an incredibly impressive season is significantly more impressive.
I mean, yeah. What he did the first...
He's 42 to 48 years old.
What he did the first 10 years of his career is out of control. And also, I saw this yesterday at the last game, at the last day of the season, or 2 days ago, that Mike Trout just quietly had 40 bombs and only played like 119 games.
He's also very good. How about this stat for Albert Pujols? Albert Pujols has finished his regular season major league career with more extra base hits than strikeouts by one.
Say that again so we can clip it.
Albert Pujols has finished his major league regular season career with more extra base hits than strikeouts. He has hit 1,405 extra base hits. That is a double, triple, or home run.
Uh-huh.
And he struck out in his career 1,404 times.
That's unbelievable.
That is fucking insane, man.
So, yeah.
That is how it came out yesterday, candidly, that in June, he considered retiring.
Yeah.
You see that? This has become like an Albert Pujols podcast.
But you know what he did?
He champions adjust, baby.
Champions adjust. He knew that he could work through it because he'd been there before. He had the experience. He had the backing of his teammates. He probably talked to Yachty. He probably talked to Waino. He's like, what do I do? And they were probably both the same. They're like, yes, we've all gone through this amount of struggle. Our body is broken. We're hurting. We don't know what to do. We don't know if we have the same confidence level as we did before.
It's confidence is everything.
But you keep working through
it. Pressure you put on yourself
internally. You keep working through it, right?
Pressure. And that's the thing, too. We've talked about this, that it doesn't matter if you're a rookie or if you're a surefire Hall of Famer. It's hard to ignore fans when you're struggling.
It is, of course.
If you are 0 for your last 30, you know it, and you're not happy about it. And then you hear people when you're on deck saying, oh, you fucking suck. Hey, hit better.
Right.
You should get cut. And then you see it in the media, and then you see it on social media, and then it just compounds. And like, you go from, man, I'm struggling, to, man, I suck.
Right.
Man, everybody hates me. Man, if I don't fix this. Joey Gallo is the perfect example. The guy would not leave his apartment in New York City because of the treatment that he received from the fans.
Right, but New York's very, very hostile.
Then he went to L.A., and I don't know enough about his stats
in the
second half, but that first week he was significantly better.
I think he had a much better time there.
Yeah, I mean, he had like four doubles in the first week because it's like, oh, I'm not hated here.
Right.
I don't have to put so much pressure. I'll go with Matt Carpenter with the Cardinals. Was just a Cardinals legend and then struggled.
Yeah.
And I know a lot of that's the shift.
Right.
It didn't mean that Cardinals fans hated him, but
no, Cardinals fans adore Matt Carpenter.
It didn't help Matt Carpenter that Cardinals fans were starting to want him cut.
Right.
And he's this Cardinals legend who knows that Cardinals fans don't want him around anymore.
It's tough.
That's tough for a human being. And so Albert Pujols was signed by the Cardinals as a quote unquote by a lot of people, including myself, nostalgia signing.
Mm-hmm.
I said it. Like, this is, you know, can he contribute to this team? Well, sure, in the locker room, but physically, yeah, maybe. And then there's a good chance, because that's how psychology works, and we both know enough Major League Baseball players to know that they're human beings, that he might have started to convince himself of that.
Right.
In June. Like, man, maybe I don't belong here.
Yeah. I mean, that's the kind of mental battle that all elite performers go through, right? Because we have this idea of them that they're unshakable, they're unbreakable, they don't have any doubts or any fears. And that's not true. They're just able to work through them, and that and we don't see the active working through them in the limelight. Like, the media doesn't portray Albert Pujols probably sitting in the locker room having these conversations, meditating, visualizing, talking with his family, thinking about his whole life, his career, can I do this, what do I do? And then they don't show all of that working through it, right? But it all happens. The doubts, the fears, the struggles, they're all there, but we just see the end point, the success of those things, like Albert having a great second half of the year and coming through and hitting the over 700 home runs and all of that stuff. But just like Babe Ruth said, right? You can't let the fear of striking out keep you from getting in the batter's box, right? And the idea is that if you are willing to hit the game-winning home run in the batter's box, you have to be willing to have the game-ending strikeout in the same batter's box.
100%.
Those two things go together.
Yep.
If I'm not willing to make the game-winning shot, then I also have to be willing to take and miss that game-winning shot. And both of those things will happen consistently. We all remember Albert Pujols' 2004 home run against Brad Lidge, right?
Mm-hmm.
Well, we don't remember any of the times he didn't get it done.
Sure.
Because he didn't always get it done.
Right.
And that's the same with any great player, any great podcast, any great student, any great anything, is that you're going to miss a lot of shots, but you still have to be willing to take them over and over and over and over and over and over again.
I'll give you a fun stat right on the heels of that. You know who holds the record for grounding into the most double plays in Major League history?
Probably Albert Pujols.
Albert Pujols.
Yep.
There you go. 703 home runs career. Surefire first ballot Hall of Famer. Has the record for most grounded in double plays in Major League history. Who holds the record for walking the most batters in Major League history?
Nolan Ryan.
He has the most strikeouts and the most walks of any pitcher to ever play the game.
Yep. And so it all goes hand in hand.
Yes.
And so we have to think about that as we're working through our own personal struggles and challenges, and we continue to spiral up and spiral up and spiral up and spiral up.
Yes.
And adjust to the situation and pivot and adjust and pivot and adjust. And have your mistakes, and
not
then
mistakes.
Know that, not mistakes, just a mistake. And then you just keep moving forward, and you keep moving forward, and you keep pivoting and evolving and learning and growing and trying and trying and trying and trying and trying and trying, and know that you're never ever gonna ever have it all figured out, but you're just gonna get closer and closer and closer to that guiding star, to that North Star, and to being the best version of you. And I think that's really quite cool. And so, speaking of that, let's make some predictions.
Let's make some predictions.
So today, on this day, right now, we have four baseball games.
Yes, we do.
First game, game one.
Can we get this out before those games are over?
I'm going to try.
Like, Friday, Saturday, Sunday's the last day of these games.
I'm going to try to get it out by tomorrow morning.
Oh, that'd be... Ben, you're the best, man.
Yeah, if Ben... I mean, depends on what Ben's work schedule is, and he also lives in Manchester.
Yes. So... Hey, come on, you Gunners. Go Arsenal. I'll buy you like a stuffed frog for helping us, because I just see his frog in the coffee.
Yeah, Ben's our video guy. He does Champions Adjust, and he does Jackson Talks, everybody. Yes. Anyway, so, okay, game one, Guardians versus Rays. Who you got in that series?
I got the Rays. Kind of mentioned it earlier, yep. But the Rays always get counted out as a wild card team in the AL East. They always compete. Guardians won the worst division in baseball, but not by a long shot. It was closer than it should have been for a 3 seed in the playoffs. Right? Mm-hmm. They're the 3 seed in the American League, and
they're not the third best.
They're the worst team of those 6 teams. Yep. Guardians are one of the hottest teams in baseball right now.
They are.
They are the Braves, but without the issue of taking games off.
Right. They have a lot of momentum.
The Rays have experience in the pitching, though.
Yep.
I have the Rays winning that series
in 3 games or 2 games.
I'm gonna go 3.
Okay.
Just because I want every game to go 3 except for the Cardinals.
I'm gonna just say something a little different. I think the Rays sweep.
Okay.
I'm just gonna say that.
Great. What gives you that?
I just think they have so much playoff experience, dude.
It's important to note, by the way, and to remind anybody who's listening and ourselves that these games are all played at one location.
Right.
These are all in Cleveland. All these games are in Cleveland.
Yeah.
It's good to
know. I know. I think that's really cool.
Yeah.
I don't really have any like other knowledge outside of what you're saying.
Sure.
To make my pick, I'm just saying I think it would be cool. I think out of all 4 series, wild card series, this one is the only one that has the serious potential to be a sweep. I think the other ones not so much.
Sure.
Maybe the Mets, just because they have 2 of the best pitchers to ever exist on the planet throwing.
Sure, but DeGrom's been human the last 2.
Right. And so I'm going to pick Rays. I think they have a ton of playoff experience. They get it done when they need to. Normally, Guardians haven't been in there in a long time.
Right.
And they have a very young squad.
This is why I think it's not going to be a sweep right there. I think that it's in Cleveland. You have Terry Francona as the manager.
Yeah.
Young Bahat. Pretty much me in my 20s. Young but hot. I'm just kidding, I'm not hot. But I was young at one point.
You're hot. You're a sexy beast.
No, thanks, man. Well, I was living in Arizona.
You got a hot wife, so you must have done something. You must have done something, right?
I got kicked the hell out of my coverage, let me tell you what. She does not let me forget it. Love you, Lulu. I think the Guardians will pull out a game.
Yeah, what you're saying is true.
They won the series, honestly.
Francona is an incredible manager. Every guy on that roster is fired the fuck up to be in the playoffs. So I could be 100% wrong. It could go the opposite direction. They could win. So
from when the Reds played the Pirates in a playing game a couple years ago,
mm-hmm.
and I was having drinks with one of the Reds players, who I'm not going to name his name. But I was having drinks with one of the Reds players, you know, during the offseason. And he told me, and they were the better team. Pirates were in their first playoff game in like 25 years, 30 years maybe. And he said that they couldn't talk to each other in the dugout. It was so loud. Like, the Reds players could not communicate with each other in the dugout. And like the third, fourth, fifth inning, they're like, hey, the crowd will settle down and we'll figure this out.
Yeah.
But then it never did. And the Pirates ended up winning the game.
Wow.
On a couple big errors from the Reds. Because of the crowd.
Uh-huh.
It was just like, and the players went in, like, hey, these Pirates fans are going to be raucous.
Right.
But we didn't realize how bad it was going to be. And by the 8th inning, they were louder than they were in the 1st inning.
Wow.
And we just couldn't get momentum.
Mm-hmm.
That stuff does matter.
It does.
It really, you look at the Cardinals, I mean, we're both big Cardinals fans. Them playing at Busch is the main reason I'm going to pick them. That's the last series we're going to talk about.
Right.
But the main reason I'm picking them is because they're playing at Busch all 3 games. And the Cardinals don't really struggle at Busch because the fans are so great.
Yeah.
And it makes a difference. So I'm curious You know, I'm going to watch the game tonight.
Right.
And within 10 minutes, I might decide, oh, never mind, Cleveland's going to sweep this series.
Mm, interesting.
It makes a difference.
So, next game, Blue Jays versus Mariners. So, we just want to point out that if you circle back to our episodes from last season.
In April.
Where we predicted two teams that we know were very close to making the postseason last year that we're going to 100% get in this year. We both predicted in unison together as a pair the Blue Jays and the Mariners would be in.
Yes.
And they did it. And so we're actually very fired up about the Blue Jays and the Mariners.
Yeah, very fired up.
And now they're playing each other and it's very exciting.
Scotty Service is the manager. I've known him since he was director of player personnel and development for the Rangers back when I was 16 years old.
Amazing.
Always root for him. Just one of the most pure-hearted, back his players up kind of guys. I'm very excited for this series.
So who do you got?
I got the Blue Jays.
You got the Blue Jays.
I'm going to go again. This is in Toronto. Uh-huh. That makes a big difference.
Huge difference.
In Toronto.
Huge difference.
The Mariners have an incredible rotation. They have Luis Castillo. They have Robbie Ray and Logan Gilbert. And they have a fantastic bullpen. But the Blue Jays have top to bottom arguably the most complete lineup in baseball.
Very, very complete.
Then you look at how the Mariners won this year. A lot of comeback wins.
Mm.
Bottom of the ninth stuff. Well, first off, they're not going to get the bat in the bottom of the ninth anymore. So that makes a difference. But also, and I use this in my picking NCAA basketball bracket stuff too, is teams that play with fire and come back late to win tend to get burnt by that.
Mm.
Eventually in the playoffs. And I think that the Blue Jays are too good to come back from behind on. Alec Manoah, first full season, second full season, has been phenomenal. And I think that just this Kevon Biggio, Vlad Guerrero Jr.
Bichette, Springer,
who has experience in playoff
baseball. Their catcher, what's his name, Kirk?
Kirk.
He's sick.
Andrew Kirk is great. So I think that plus the crowd is going to
they're going to be ready to go.
2001 is the last time. I mean, we're talking 21 years ago.
Mm-hmm.
I am 34, which means I was 13 years old the last time the Mariners.
When Ichiro Suzuki took the Mariners.
Ichiro Suzuki took the Mariners to 106 plus wins,
uh-huh,
and then lost to the Yankees.
Yep.
I had an Ichiro poster in my bathroom as I was brushing my teeth. I had a Ichiro throwing poster. The Blue Jays are in Toronto.
So you got Blue Jays in three.
I have the Blue Jays in three. Yeah.
Blue Jays in three.
In bold prediction on this, I think Luis Castillo is not going to make it through four innings.
In game one?
In game one.
Wow.
He's going to get knocked out quick.
Interesting. So I'm going to take Mariners in three.
Okay.
I like the Mariners.
We both love these teams.
I know. Yeah. So I just wanted to take the opposite pick of you. Because either way, I
wish it was a 7-game series.
Either way, I'm just fired up that they're in it.
Oh, man.
I'm also, I love it.
Oh, it's incredible.
It's going to be a really good series.
If only this could be a 7-game series.
Is Julio Rodriguez fully healthy?
Oh, yeah, he's back.
Okay.
We need a home run his first at bat back. So
okay.
He's okay.
So cheers to him, his contract. All that stuff. That's quite cool for him. So it's cool that he can cap off that kind of initial season. He had an incredible home run derby, incredible season, gets the contract, has his team in the playoffs, and so we'll see what he can do for the next 15 years that he's in the in that organization.
Honestly, it's cool that we're in Dallas, in where the Rangers are in the same division as the Mariners, mm-hmm, because I'm really excited to raise my son on watching people like Julio Rodriguez or Mike Trout, who's also in the AL West,
mm-hmm,
play baseball. And, the Cardinals have, the Rangers have some really good young talent too.
Yep.
So there's just really good talent in the AL West right now that's going to be a lot of fun to watch.
Absolutely.
With the exception, the A's are always stacked with young talent that leave.
The A's are an incredible organization.
Depending on what you're looking at, yes.
I think they need to leave Oakland.
They need to leave Oakland or the owner needs to sell.
Yeah.
Because they have this incredible track record of developing talent,
mm-hmm,
and then sell them off because they don't want to pay them.
Right.
Like the fact that Matt Olson
is a stud. He's a stud.
But it's just ridiculous that Frankie Montas, the team has Frankie Montas and And then Matt Olson to start the year, and they don't win 70 games.
Right.
Okay. It's bad for baseball.
One more before we get to the Cards Phillies. We have Mets versus Padres. So the Mets basically had a historic fumble in September.
Yes.
Absolutely just completely fumbled it. Fumbled the division title.
Yeah.
Padres have basically bought every single person they could over the last couple years and still haven't really gotten it done.
Right.
Until squeaking into the playoffs this year.
These are two powerhouses that everybody expects to lose in the next round.
There's no Tatis Jr.
Nope.
There is obviously Manny Machado, one of the best players in the game.
Might possibly win the MVP.
There is Juan Soto, obviously.
Who has had a very tough second half.
Bad.
Because he's a human being. And the pressure of being bought for the talent that he's bought for, he hears what people are saying.
Right.
And he hears the boos when he's not hitting well. And I think it's going to be beneficial to him not be hitting in San Diego in this series. I think he'll be better because he'll be in New York.
Yeah.
Because he won't hear a home crowd booing him.
Mm. So
that's going to be good.
And then we just, as we mentioned earlier, we have Mets with Scherzer and DeGrom going 1-2. Yeah,
that is, that's why I'm going
Which Mets. If you're a hitter, I mean, that's like
So
1A, 1A.
Yeah. You're at, so we talk about the best team money can buy. I look at the Mets that way too.
Yeah.
The Mets have spent an incredible amount of money to create this 102 win team with Buck Showalter at the helm.
Right.
The future Hall of Fame manager. You got the Citi Field crowd.
Yep.
Mets fans are annoyingly passionate about their team. You have Jacob DeGrom and Max Scherzer. You have a fantastic bullpen, probably possibly one of the best relievers in baseball. And Diaz, Edwin Diaz, with one of the best intros.
Awesome, yes.
With Timmy Trumpet, up on the trumpet, who actually did that live last month, and that was so cool. Did you see that?
Yeah, I did see that.
Trumpet comes and like just played it for him, and I got chills. Like
it's goosebumps. That's what it's all about.
I just don't think that the Padres can go to New York City and win two of three games. I don't think they can win two games.
Yeah, I'm with you on this 100%.
I think it's Mets in three.
Yeah, I agree with you 100%. Pete Alonso is. I don't know if there's a...
You love him. I do not.
Well, as you're looking at his season...
He's a good baseball player.
And you're looking at how valuable he is to his squad,
yes.
Which is what you're looking at when you think about MVP, most valuable player.
Sure.
The Mets would be zero places without him.
Yeah, he's like Bryce Harper to the Phillies. So
right.
The Phillies would not have played the season if
Bryce Harper would have. No, but I mean, you really have to think about Pete Alonso's season as a whole, right? He carried that offense for a long time. And even down the stretch when they were playing poorly, he was still performing and driving runs in and hitting home runs. So I'm interested to see him play in the playoffs. But I think...
one of those guys who puts the team on the back.
Yeah. I don't know him personally, so that doesn't really matter.
Padres' bullpen is also very suspect.
It is suspect. Their whole team is suspect.
Yeah.
They've fumbled the ball.
Yeah. They have so much...
Over and over and over, they fumbled.
But then, like, the Mets, like, it's a whole thing that we talked about in April. Like, hey, the Mets spent so much money, but, yeah, the Mets are going to Met.
You know.
The Mets. So, that's kind of like where the Padres are right now. Like, what's going on with you guys that you have great pitching, great lineup, on paper a good bullpen, but you can't put it together.
Right.
Ever. And whose fault is that? Usually the managers.
Managers. Down to player chemistry, personnel, mindset.
Which is a manager thing.
Right? What they're building, the things they're talking about, leadership, all of these things.
The blame is going to end up falling on their general manager who's put together.
It's never, in Major League Baseball, it's never talent or physical skills.
It's never one person either.
And it's never one person, right? It's a whole unit coming together. Right? Baseball is an individual team sport.
I would love to see the Padres win a World Series this year. I would. I would love to see this team finally come together and do it.
Yeah.
But yeah, I
don't see it happening.
I don't see it happening.
Okay, so we got Mets there. And then the last series that we'll talk about today till we reconvene as soon as possible is Cardinals versus Phillies. You have the Phillies.
What? Yeah, the Cardinals are in the playoffs.
Stop. So you have the Phillies team who has two of the best players in the league, in Wheeler and Bryce Harper.
Yeah.
Bryce Harper was having one of his best years ever.
Number two.
Right.
Pitcher, by the way.
Bryce Harper's having one of his best years ever.
Yes.
until he got injured. Until he got injured.
Yep.
And then basically Kyle Schwarber just picked up the slack.
Dude, Kyle Schwarber, what a signing he was.
He just picked up the slack, dropped 46 bombs. Mm-hmm. Wheeler.
Lost Pujols in the home run derby, whatever.
Yeah.
Yep.
Didn't matter. And then you have Wheeler, who had another great year. I think .270 ERA or something like that. Bryce Harper still hasn't got back to full form.
There's Mark. Mark Bodson with a Cardinals onesie on.
That a boy.
Yeah, he's got a Cardinals
onesie. And so we'll see, right? If Bryce Harper gets hot, that's tough. That's tough to beat. If Schwarber stays the way he's going, and some other guys in the lineup, Realmuto. What's
his name? Realmuto, JT Realmuto.
Yep. And their first baseman is really good as well.
Okay.
I forgot his name.
I just pull up their lineup.
But that doesn't matter. And then they're facing, but again, the Phillies haven't been in the playoffs since 2011.
Right.
So that's a huge thing.
Here's a fun fact about Zach Wheeler, right? Shout out to, I'm part of like a, real quick and did the track, I'm part of a Twitter Cardinals group chat called the Bench Mafia Grinders that I was added to like midway through the season.
Mm-hmm.
And, Brad, shout out to you. Right out to several of you. Danny Trout. Ken Merritt sent out something today. Zach Wheeler's pitch count in his three starts since returning from missing a month with forearm tendonitis. 58 pitches, 62 pitches, 77 pitches.
Mm.
So the question is twofold. How far will they push him?
Right.
Because, yes, he is incredible. And yes. The Cardinals have struggled immensely hitting him.
Mm-hmm.
How far will they push him? And can playoff Cardinals lineup push him out quicker?
Right. Because playoff Cardinals lineup is different than regular season Cardinals.
They released their lineup today. And it is it's a doozy.
And so, and then Phillies obviously are matched up against the Cardinals, which are a absolutely postseason squad.
Yeah.
They're a postseason squad.
Did you know that?
And they have two of the best players in the world on their team.
Ever played the game.
Who have two of their best seasons they've ever had.
Four of the best players that ever played the game on their
well, right yeah, now. We have, you know, Yachty and Albert, who are the two of the best at their position ever.
And then Goldschmidt and Arenado.
And then Goldschmidt and Arenado, who are two of the best at their position right now, currently.
Quite possibly the best reliever in the game this year in Ryan Helsley.
Yep. And so, I think starting pitching needs to come together for the Cards.
That's the thing about the Cardinals. They don't have a true number one. Their true number one this year was Miles Mikolas, who's not even starting game one.
Mm-hmm.
Their de facto ace is Wainwright, who had a 7 ERA in September.
Yeah.
Their long-term ace has been Jack Flaherty, who's been hurt for 2 years, but has gotten better with every start in the last month and a half.
Right.
He's going to be a good bullpen option.
So those are all question marks, big question marks.
Jordan Montgomery, who came over from the Yankees, is not in the rotation right now. He's a lefty who was borderline unhittable for a while and then kind of cooled off. And so he's a lefty bullpen option right now.
Right. And so those are the questions for the Cardinals. The questions for the Phillies are, you know, how long is Wheeler going to be able to go? How many pitches?
Yep.
And will Bryce Harper get hot?
And can they... You know, look at this lineup for the Cardinals. Lars Nubar, who's one of the best arms in right field right now.
I like
one
Lars.
Of the greatest names in freaking baseball, but he's also a really fun baseball player.
Yep.
Leading off, Albert Pujols, Paul Goldschmidt, Nolan Arenado are number 2, 3, and 4. Then you have quite possibly the best two-strike hitter in the playoffs, and Brendan Donovan hitting 5. Then you go Dylan Carlson,
mm-hmm.
Corey Dickerson, Yadier Molina, and Tommy Edman.
Tommy Edman's a stud.
So you have a leadoff at 9 and a leadoff at 1.
Right.
With, you know, 3, 4, 5 hitters that can be interchangeable at 2, 3, and 4 right now.
Mm-hmm.
And they put, you know, a normal number 2 guy in the 5 hole just to wear you out before you get to the towards the bottom of the lineup.
Right.
And that's Ari Marmol, who's his first year managing. He's 35 years old.
Doing a great job.
He won the Central this year. And he's it's very smart. Because then you have Quintana, who came over from the Pirates and, you know, trade for peanuts. Miles Mikolas, who's been hurt a lot, but he's come out. He's basically the best pitcher on the team this year as your number 1 and 2 guy. Then you have Jordan Hicks. You have Jack Flaherty. You have Adam Wainwright is in the bullpen.
Mm-hmm.
Jordan Montgomery's in the bullpen. They have this bullpen that's just like if you're down by one going into the seventh inning to the Cardinals, you ain't getting the run.
Right.
Like, the Cardinals just have to win the first six innings.
It's going to be an awesome series.
It's going to be fun.
But I think both of us have Cardinals in three.
Two.
You have them in two?
Yep. You got Yadi and Pujols, Ryan Helsley, Goldie, Nada, Brandon Donovan, Nubar, Quintana, Nicklaus. At Busch Stadium, best fans in baseball, Cardinals sweep the Phillies.
Cool. I'm locked in. I think that's a great way to end the episode. Cardinals sweeping the Phillies.
Fire me up. The game starts in 2 hours, and I'll start drinking in 1 hour. So here we go.
So beautiful. Any last minute thoughts you want to drop in before we close this episode one of our postseason edition?
Any new listeners, thank you so much for listening. Please share, like, subscribe. Let us know your thoughts. Let us know what we can be doing better. Let us know what you want out of this. Again, this is kind of a special episode time for us. We generally talk about the mental aspect of youth baseball, but it's October, and we are running a fall program that has a scrimmage this weekend.
Yep.
We're doing scrimmages, but we're not actually pushing them into playing, and we talked about that in the previous podcast. It's better for their arm health to take it easy. That's great. So we're talking about this right now, and hopefully some of my new Cardinals friends on Twitter are going to be listening and then sharing it to their friends, and let us know what you think, and then stay tuned for more guests after the season, and then next year we'll get back into youth baseball.
Exactly. All information about us is at champsadjust.com, right? All of our previous episodes, the details of our mindset program, you have merchandise, we do custom team orders, all of that stuff, champsadjust.com, everything you need. Also, we're on Spotify, Apple, YouTube, all of that good stuff. You can follow Coach Bods and I on social as well through our Champs Adjust socials. But thank you. Enjoy playoff baseball. I love it. Happy October. We'll see you in a few days. Cheers.
Hey, and don't ever forget.
Ever forget.
That Champions Adjust.
Champions Adjust.